Blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which word in ardent evermore shall be.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Well, thank you for joining us again, Central Church of Christ. This is January the 31st when you're hearing this. And we're grateful that you have joined us this morning for our online service. We are still going to provide this means of your meeting together with us as more and more people feel comfortable coming out to our live service on Sunday morning at 10:30. We are grateful that you've joined us online, and I pray that you will get the most out of this message today. We're in the middle of a series. The series is called Remember, and we have already had several messages. One is the importance of remembering in the mind of God, of how God throughout time has arranged things in, even before the days of the Israelites and the Old Testament law. He arranged things so that man could remember the covenants and the various things that God is doing in order to work on our behalf. And so he's already done a number of things to help us to remember important matters in our lives. And then we talked about our spiritual well-being. We need to remember to take care of ourselves spiritually. And I went through a number of things that God expects us to remember to do on a regular basis to take care of ourselves spiritually. And then we talked about God's provision, about remembering that God is providing for us. Because when we forget to do that, there are several things that can happen. One is we worry. Another is that sometimes we try to get our needs met in illegitimate ways. And we sometimes just don't believe that God is good because he doesn't always do exactly what we want him to do in the way we want him to do it and in the time period that we want him to do it. And so we need to remember God's provision. And then last week we looked at our siblings, remembering our siblings, and about how it's important to remember our brothers and sisters in Christ. It is easy to forget, particularly in this day when people are kind of out of sight and therefore out of mind. It's easy to forget one another. Today we're going to end our series with probably the most important message that we could give in regard to remembering, and that is to remember Jesus. We want to remember Jesus. But I want to begin with what Jesus said about another occasion and about how important it was to remember another person in Scripture. It's found in Matthew chapter 26, verses 6 through 13. On this occasion, while Jesus was in Bethany in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, which she poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. And when the disciples saw this, they were indignant. "Why this waste?" they asked. "This perfume could have been sold for a high price and the money given to the poor." Aware of this, Jesus said to them, "Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me. When she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. Truly I tell you, Wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. And here we are over 2,000 years later, and I'm reminding you of what this woman did in order before Jesus went to his death, and the way she prepared him for his burial. And so we remember her today. This emphasizes, though, to me, that there are significant events, even in the life of Jesus, that Jesus does not want us to forget, that we need to remember these things. It was important to Jesus that this woman and her selfless act and devotion would not be forgotten. It made a profound impression on Jesus, even though it seemed like such a waste to the apostles. What seems like a waste to the world is, for us followers of Christ, worth remembering. Well, let's make our way through this message today about remembering Jesus. And of course, probably the easiest place and the most logical place to start is the events around the Lord's Supper. In Luke chapter 22, verse 15 and following, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat the Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and he said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink it again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Of course, when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, he did it for one reason. He did it was in order to give us a means by which to remember him on a regular basis. Of course, in our church, we take the Lord's Supper every first day of the week, and we have that opportunity every first day to remember the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And we're going to come back to this idea of remembering the covenant in a few moments, but that was specifically what Jesus was referring to on this occasion, because he says in verse 19, he gave thanks and he broke it, he gave it to them, and he says, "This is my body, do this in remembrance of me. And then when he took the cup, he says, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Now, Paul later on, of course, spoke about this when he was trying to correct the Corinthian brethren because they were abusing the Lord's Supper. They were not taking it the way it was intended, and they certainly were not remembering Jesus in any significant way in the taking of the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. In fact, Paul says, look, what you're actually doing is not even the Lord's Supper anymore, because it seems like you're not only forgetting your siblings and you're not taking care of them, but you're not honoring the covenant agreement between you and God and the force of that agreement. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23, Paul writes, he says, "For I received from the Lord what I passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me.'" Now, we often, and I don't believe this is on our table, but many of the tables that represent the table, the Lord's Supper table, have the words engraved on the tables, "Do this in remembrance of me." And we definitely want to honor Jesus in that particular way. But I think we need to go just a little bit deeper into this subject about what specifically are we supposed to be remembering when it comes to Jesus. Well, there's at least, I think, four things that I've written down here. Let's see, one, two, three, four things that specifically Jesus says are important for us to remember when we remember him. The first one is found in 2 Timothy chapter 2, the first one I'm going to talk about. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8 and verse 9, Paul wrote, he says, "Remember Jesus Christ. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering even to the point of being chained like a criminal. but God's word is not chained. Now, I want us to talk just for a moment about the descent of Jesus from David himself. Why was this so important? Paul says, I can sum up my gospel in two things. One is that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, and secondly, Jesus Christ descended from David. Now, why was that so important? Well, let's look at a couple of other passages. When you think of descent from David, there's one word that needs to come to mind, and that is the word Messiah. Because every Jew knew that Jesus Christ not only was going to be a descendant of Abraham, but they also knew that he was going to be a descendant through the tribe of Judah. And then more specifically, they knew that he was going to be a descendant of David. He was going to come from the house of David. So when Paul says, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David, what he is saying is that remember that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. He is the one that was prophesied, that was promised in the Old Testament, and he is the one who can trace his lineage all the way back through David and all the way back to Abraham, establishing his credentials in the human form as his credentials as being the Savior of the world. In Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 3 or 4, Paul says, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God. The gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now we'll come back to the resurrection in a moment, but notice in this passage, Paul includes in this passage the same two things that he included in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 8, the resurrection of Jesus and the descendants from David in the Old Testament. In Luke chapter 1, verses 31 through 33, when the angel was talking to Mary, he says, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. One of the reasons that the inscription was put over the head of Jesus was that the Jews who believed in him considered him to be the king of the Jews, to be the one who would sit upon David's throne. But when God promised this to Mary, he wanted to make sure that she understood that the person that was going to come into the world through her was going to be the descendant of David. He was going to be the one who would ascend to the throne of David. And there's so much in Scripture about this. We don't have time to unpack that whole thing. But it definitely is a clear picture in the New Testament that it was important for the Christians of that day, and I believe for us today, to remember that Jesus is descended from David, that he is the Messiah, that he is the King, and that therefore, if we forget that, we will forget the uniqueness of Jesus. We will forget how he fulfilled all the Old Testament prophecies, how that he was the fulfillment of the promise that was made to Abraham and to David. We will forget those things, and we'll begin to look at Jesus in an ordinary way. He was not an ordinary person. He was the one who was to come. He was the Messiah. And then there's the resurrection. We must remember the resurrection. Again, going back to 2 Timothy 2 and verse 8, he says, this is my gospel, that Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel. And so the gospel of Jesus Christ is rooted in the resurrection of Jesus. Of course, it's rooted in the death and burial as well. But he centers on the resurrection because of what Paul said in Romans chapter 1 when he said that, in verse 2, he says the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son who is as to his earthly life, was a descendant of David. And then he says, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. So in the earthly sense, Jesus was the Messiah based on his descent from David. But in the heavenly sense, he was appointed to be the Son of God because of his resurrection from the dead. If you read in Acts chapter 1, you will see that Peter makes it very clear that when this was prophesied by David himself in the Old Testament, that it was clear that it was not David that he was talking about, but the descendant of David, who not only rose from the dead, but also was seated at the right hand of power of God and declared to be the Son of God forever and ever. So we have two things that are covered here, two things we must not forget about Jesus. Number one is, he is the Messiah in fulfillment of the promises and the prophecies of the Old Testament. And number two, he is the Son of God because of his resurrection from the dead. Death no longer has mastery over him. We must not forget those two things, because when we do, we forget the uniqueness of Jesus and we forget that it's only through him that we can be saved. Now, the third thing I want to call to your attention about not forgetting is the covenant. God does not forget his covenants. God is a God who remembers his covenant. Remember, we talked about the rainbow in the sky. And the rainbow was put in the sky, according to the Old Testament, in order to remind God that he should never destroy the earth again by water. Now, I know it reminds us as well. When I see a rainbow, I think of the promise of God. But I'm glad that when God sees the rainbow, he remembers his covenant, he remembers his promises, and he remembers that he promised not to destroy the earth again by water. I'm happy about that, because if he taps me on the shoulder and said, build an ark, we're all in trouble. You better learn to swim, tread water, because it's not going to happen. But his covenant is important to remember. I want to show you a couple of places where this just stands out in the scripture. In Psalm chapter 106, verses 40 through 45, Psalm 106, 40 through 45, the psalmist says, therefore the Lord was angry with his people and abhorred his inheritance. He gave them into the hands of the nations, and their foes ruled over them. Their enemies oppressed them and subjected them to their power. Many times he delivered them, but they were bent on rebellion, and they wasted away in their sin. It sounds pretty ominous here that over and over again, that not only does God rescue his people, but they go back to sinning again, and he has to rescue them over and over again. The book of Judges is a good example of that. And so it says that, yet he took note of their distress when he heard their cry. For their sake he remembered his covenant, and out of his great love he relented. God remembers his covenant. And even though he became very angry with his children, he knew that he had made a promise to Abraham that through his seed all the nations of the earth would be blessed. And he knew that he could not allow the Jewish people to be utterly destroyed. And so he saved them over and over again, even though they continued to rebel against him for the most part of their history. But God remembered his covenant, and we're glad he is a God who remembers. And then in Isaiah 54, I want to read verses 1 through 10 and see how important this is in the Old Testament of God remembering his covenant. Because we better be glad that God remembers his covenant, because sometimes we forget the covenant that we have made with God or that he has made with us. But God doesn't forget that covenant. It's very important to him. It says in Isaiah 54, 1 through 10, "Sing, barren woman, you who never bore a child, burst into song, shout for joy. You who were never in labor, because more are the children of the desolate woman than of her who has a husband, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, stretch your tent curtains wide. Do not hold back, lengthen your cords, strengthen your stakes. For you will spread out to the right and to the left. Your descendants will dispossess nations and settle in their desolate cities. Do not be afraid. You will not be put to shame. Do not fear disgrace. You will not be humiliated. You will forget the shame of your youth and remember no more the reproach of your widowhood. For your Maker is your husband. The Lord Almighty is his name. The Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer. He is called the God of all the earth. The Lord will call you back as if you were a wife deserted and distressed in spirit, a wife who married young, only to be rejected, says your God. For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with deep compassion I will bring you back. In a surge of anger I hid my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting kindness I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. To me, this is like the days of Noah, when I swore that the waters of Noah would never again cover the earth. So now I have sworn not to be angry with you, never to rebuke you again. Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. Notice what he says here. God says, I'm not going to forget my covenant with you. That even though you make me so angry sometimes, and I have to punish you, I have to discipline you for your good, but I will never forget my covenant with you. I will never stop showing compassion and love for you. I will always come back to you. I will not remove my covenant of peace with you because I am a compassionate God and I love you. I am so glad we serve a God who is like that, because we can do a lot of stupid things down here. We can act in a lot of ways that I'm sure that God is just not happy, that shakes his head at us, and sometimes we just may make him just downright angry at us. But God says, I'm not going to forget my covenant with you. I've made this covenant, and even though you may deny me, I'll never deny you. You know, it's important for us to know that God remembers his covenant, but notice that's exactly what he says for us on the other side of the coin, never to do as well. Don't forget the covenant of God. In Luke 22, verse 20, he says, in the same way after supper, he took the cup saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Why? Because it's a new covenant. It's a new covenant in my blood. Don't forget your covenant. You know what a covenant is? It's an agreement with God. God is the one who initiates the covenant. He's the one who enters into a covenant agreement with him. And we accept the terms of that covenant, and he becomes our God, and we become his people. There are many blessings that come with God being our God and us being his people. And that covenant is a covenant of love for all generations. And we must never forget that covenant that we've entered into. It's a loving relationship, just as a husband should not forget the covenant that he has made with his wife, or the wife the covenant that she's made with her husband. We must never forget the covenant that has been made with God. We remember the agreement that we have with Jesus. And then finally, I want us to remember Jesus' words. In John chapter 14, verses 25 and 26, as Jesus was talking to his apostles, he says, and all this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives, and do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. One of the reasons they did not need to be afraid was because they were going to be reminded of everything Jesus said to them. One of the things, and I know I've hammered this in other messages in this series, but one of the things we must never, ever forget is the words of Jesus. The words of Jesus. In John chapter 12, verse 14, it says, Jesus found a young donkey, and he sat on it. And as it is written, he says, Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. And at first the disciples did not understand all this. They did not remember what this was all about. Only after Jesus was glorified, after his resurrection, did they realize, did they remember that these things have been written about him and that these things have been done to him. It was only after they happened that they remembered that these things were prophesied about Jesus, him riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, and that those things had actually happened. We must so remember the things that Jesus said and did. It is the core of our relationship with him to know him in order to be able to tell the world, let me tell you about Jesus. Let me tell you the wonderful things he did, the wonderful things he said. In Acts chapter 11 and verse 15 and following, he says, as I begin to speak, this is Peter talking on the occasion of Cornelius' household being saved. He says, as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them as he had come on us in the beginning. And then I remembered what the Lord had said. John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So if God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way? Peter says, look, as I was teaching these Gentiles, and I'm sure in the pit of his stomach, Peter had this idea, I shouldn't be here, I shouldn't be here, I shouldn't be talking to these Gentiles, I shouldn't be in their house. What is a Jew doing in the home of a Gentile? But then he remembered the word of Jesus. And when he saw the baptism of the Holy Spirit come down upon Cornelius and his household, he put that event together with the words of Jesus and remembered that if Jesus accepts these people, then he too should accept them. So many things can be solved in our life if in the midst of things where we have conflict and controversy, if we can just stop and remember the words of Jesus. That will save us so many times. If we can stop and say, but Jesus says, maybe it's, but Jesus says, do unto others as I would have others do unto me. But Jesus says, love my enemies. But Jesus says, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But Jesus says, come and follow me. But Jesus says, deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow after me. On and on it goes when we remember the words of Jesus. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 35, it's interesting because the words that were remembered in this case are words that are not recorded in the life of Christ. They're nowhere found in Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. But in Acts 20 and verse 35, when Paul was talking to the Ephesian elders, he says, in everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words that Jesus himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Paul says, the reason I did the work that I did among you and the way I did the work among you, because I remembered what Jesus said, it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And he quoted Jesus, and had he not remembered those words, then we would have never known those words because they're not found in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But now we can quote some more words of Jesus just simply because Paul remembered them. What should we do? We should remember the... And you know what? I really believe we probably need to go back to the days when we memorized Scripture more. You know, storing Scripture up in our hearts, I believe that we've become a little bit lazy in that regard. And I understand just memorizing Scripture doesn't make you a Christian. But I also know that you've got to be able to call to mind what Jesus said. You know, I cannot emphasize how important that is for you to constantly be referencing in every situation of your life, referencing what Jesus and the apostles said. And living by that, never forgetting it. Well, as the Hindus remembers the words of the Vedas, and the Buddha remembers the word of the Tipitaka, and the Muslims remember the words of the Quran, we Christians must never forget to remember Jesus, his origin as the Son of David, his resurrection, his covenant, and his words. May we all remember Jesus in everything that we do. Well, I hope you'll stay around with us for a few minutes. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And thank you for joining us this morning. You can go to our website, centralsarasota.org. You can find other messages there that we have recorded in the past and also premieres that will come in the future. And thank you for again joining us today.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there? Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
Well, thank you for joining us for the Lord's Supper today. I want us to go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I read in my message today that section that starts in verse 23. And we read that often on the first day of the week when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. It's probably the most, other than maybe one of the accounts of the Lord's Supper in the Gospels, it's probably the most read account in churches of Christ, at least around the world, to read that almost every Sunday. So we're very familiar with verse 23 and following, but sometimes I think we forget some of the context of those verses and why Paul brought them up. So I want to go back to verse 17 and begin there and put into context what he says, starting in verse 23. So verse 17 says, "In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. So then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat, for when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter." You know, Paul was pretty upset with them for the way that they were treating the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is a holy event. It is a celebration. It's not necessarily a somber occasion because we're celebrating what God has done for us. Yeah, we're celebrating the deliverance from our sin, and so we should be rejoicing in it. But it is an occasion that is very holy and very sacred because it is a time where we are communing with God, we're communing with one another. It is one of the greatest expressions of the gospel of when we take the Lord's Supper. But on the occasion here and in the church at Corinth, they had fallen into a very bad habit. And that is, they were using the occasion of the Lord's Supper to promote divisions. Some of the richer people were bringing huge meals, and they were sharing those meals with one another, while the poor people in the church, because there were many slaves that had come to Christ in the church, they had very little, and they would be left out of these feasts. And it was not good. They would even sometimes get drunk in these feasts, not celebrating the Lord's Supper at all. And that's why Paul says, it's not the Lord's Supper that you eat. And I call your attention to that today because if we're going to remember Jesus in the right way, if we're going to honor him in the way that he should be honored, we need to do it in a way that actually does honor him. Now, I've never been in an assembly where anybody got drunk. We don't serve enough of anything. It's a pretty small little cup for anybody to get drunk. But I have seen people who do seem to be so distracted during the taking of the Lord's Supper. And they seem to not be taking seriously. And again, I don't want to judge exactly what's going on in people's minds, but I do know there is a certain decorum. There's a certain being into it, being tuned in to what we're all about and who we're supposed to be concentrating on. It's not a time for us to be playing on our cell phones. It's not a time for us to be joking around about things that have nothing to do with the Lord's Supper. It is a time, and we can celebrate, and I believe we probably should do the Lord's Supper a little bit differently, where we can share together and talk to one another. And I know that's very difficult in our settings that we have. But I also know that we can give a much more serious, dedicated, focused view of the Lord's Supper. So today, let's remember Jesus, remember his body, and remember his blood. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the body of Jesus. It is so sacred. Father, you are the one who gave Jesus this body. You're the one who offered him up as a sacrifice for the forgiveness of our sins. Father, help us to never forget him. That in our daily walk, every minute of the day, help us to always, always have Jesus in our mind. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Father in heaven, we remember the new covenant in your blood, the covenant agreement that we have with you through Jesus Christ. We know, Father, the covenant was established by the blood of Christ, just as covenants in the Old Testament were established by the blood of animals. But Father, we are so precious to know that this covenant is rooted and grounded in the blood of Jesus. And Father, I know you'll never forget your covenant to us, and help us to never forget our covenant with you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. We invite those who are members of the Central Church of Christ to go online. You can make a contribution there at centralsarasota.org. And we're thankful for your continued support of this ministry. We also call your attention to continuing to support the ministry of the Central Missions International, including Joshua Village, and the obligation that we have on a monthly basis to take care of those orphans in that place. And so I ask you to continue to be mindful and remember the poor, as we talked about last week. And so, again, thank you for joining us today, and God bless you until next time.
Healing.